dear Elodie. Thank you for having us. This next song that we're going to sing is all about God's sacrifice that he made for us. And every single day, just think about all the things that were on his back as he went up that rugged trail. So think about that.
Oh, people of God say amen.
Amen.
Amen. I want to ask that you would stand with me, if you would, in reverence to the reading of God's holy word, if you're able. To read Gospel according to Luke chapter 19 verses 1 through 10. Luke chapter 19 verses 1 through 10 in the New International Version say, Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but he could not, because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, he has gone to be the guest of a sinner. But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor, and if I've cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount. Jesus said to him, today, salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. Amen. Amen. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God for his word. I'd like to tag this particular text and message for these brief moments of sharing we had together this morning with the title, No Limits. No Limits. The text to which God has drawn our attention today brings to light some interesting conversations about limitations. Zacchaeus in the text is limited by his height, by his occupation, and by public perception of the kind of person he really is. He's been labeled and limited by those who had the power to enforce and impose their limits on his life. That, in essence, is the definition of any negative ism, whether it's racism or sexism. It is having a belief about the limitations of a person or a group of people based on their gender, their ethnicity, their age, or their sexual orientation, and that you have the power and influence to impose your bias on their lives. These times in the text mirrored our current conditions. Times in the text were dark and dank and dreary. They were divided and they were delicate. And Jesus seems to always identify with those who have been typecast, limited, and left out. Perhaps Jesus identifies with them because he understands what it is to be limited by public perception, to be limited by your lineage, to be limited by those with the authority to keep you isolated, limited in your access to the inner circle. Jesus can identify because he was bound by negative limitations. He came into the world to save it, but because he did not come in riding on a stallion like a conquering king, didn't act like other proud and arrogant men, he was born in an obscure village in poverty, had poor parents, and didn't have a tailor-made wardrobe, they limited and labeled Jesus as just another man, and we nailed him to a cross. The church in the text has been limited by our obsession with social success and an infatuation with a value system that's based on our self-interest, not on self-sacrifice. We've been limited by, because we're localized in our interests, we're earthbound in our programming and structure-bound in our destiny. We have become, in the words of the late Dr. Frederick Sampson, a big body of self-subsistence with one small tail of kingdom enterprise. We are limited in the church by the many churches that infiltrates the local church. Churches have a little church in that corner, a little church over there, a little church on the ministry team, a little church in the pulpit, a little church on the security ministry. And these churches are limited because they ain't got no dealings with each other. Then there are church groups that will give all of their energy and effort and their minds only to the program that they participate in, and when they're through with that, they don't do anything for anybody else. They'll come for their own celebration, but we'll not celebrate with anybody else. We are limiting ourselves.
ourselves. Let me add parenthetically that some limits that are placed on us are legitimate: speed limits, crowd limits, in a building, medicine limits, calorie limits. But there are other limits which are oppressive, vindictive, and violating to the human condition. And so today, our society continues to limit people based on some mythical, narrow-minded, blinkered view of success and access. See, people are erroneously limited based on their environment, their upbringing, their economics, limited by under-experience and over-experience. And guess what? Whenever somebody tells you that you are overqualified, what they're really saying to you is that I'm intimidated by your level of experience. Since I'm in a position to hire you, there's a limit to how much experience I'm going to let you have, because you might take my job. See, some people will let you have a job, they'll let you have some money as long as you're silent and unassuming. But the moment you speak up for right, Colin Kaepernick, the moment you express your religious convictions or your political conviction, the moment you stand up for your brother or your sister, the moment you have an opinion, they'll try to limit you and shut your mouth. See, some folks are limited by their zip code, their area code, their address, and assumptions made about where you're from. You do know the power doesn't get turned back on in every neighborhood at the same time. See, some folk are limited by where they are and what tax bracket they're in. Life is full of unfriendly and unhealthy limits. We will then limit ourselves, limited by fear of failure, fear of success, fear of change, fear of adversity. Everywhere men and women are confronted by fears that often appear wrapped in strange clothes. We fear that every symptom we have is evidence of some disease. But the truth is that in God, there are no limits. God has the ability to supersede any limits that afflict you. God can keep the limit from being your liability. Because the fact is that God has no limits. God is not restricted to our time or our space. God is not resigned to operate on your schedule or my schedule. God has no limits. There's no limit to his power, to his presence, or to God's peace. There's no limit to his goodness, his grace, or his greatness. No limit to his love, his leadership, or his life. God has no limits. Oswald Chambers, he said, the spirit of God is always the spirit of liberty. The spirit that is not of God is the spirit of bondage, the spirit of oppression and depression. The spirit of God convicts vividly and intensely, but he's always the spirit of liberty or freedom. When you get into God's great free life, you discover that that's the way God meant you to live. The glorious liberty of the children of God. Where the spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty, not limitations. This text is a prime example of the gravity of God's grace in our lives. It is a limitless favor that rests on you because of God's great mercy. See, Jesus shows up to let Zacchaeus know that there are no limits to the power of his love. Your height, your profession, your reputation, your pedigree, your profile, your power don't matter, because once Jesus shows up, your limitations become his opportunity. Y'all ain't feeling that yet. Limitations often lead to ingenuity and creativity. See, the limitations of darkness led to the invention of electricity. The limitations of pain led to advances in medical science. Limitations can push us and motivate us to improve our collective welfare. David put it like this: it was good for me that I've been afflicted. It's good that I understand my own limitations, because my limitations taught me how to depend on my God. Come here, Paul. Paul testified, I rejoice in my infirmities, because my infirmities expose me to the power of the grace of Almighty God. And I learned that that grace is sufficient to meet my need. Where I'm weak, he sends his strength. So because his strength is made perfect in my weakness, I gotta understand that I've got no excuse for living a dull, dark life, a devoid of service and sacrifice, because the truth is that in God, I've got no limitations. I've got no limits as long as I trust in the Lord. But I hear you asking the question, Pastor, what does it mean to have no limits in God? Zacchaeus helps us to answer the question in three ways. First, you got to understand that since you got no limits, you're not limited by your past experiences. You're not limited by your past experiences. It's clear from the dialogue in the text that Zacchaeus wasn't welcome into the clubs and the cliques of the spiritually elite in the text. He wasn't invited to the cookouts and the barbecues. What sent invitations to the weddings or the birthday parties? The sight of Zacchaeus make folks mad. Angry because of his profession. Angry because he was too short. Angry because he didn't have the right name and didn't know the right people. He was educated and enlightened. He was wealthy, but he had a past, part real and part perceived, that made folks stay away from him. He may have done some things he should not have done. May have collected from some folk who were in dire straits. He may have had to levy taxes for unpaid fees. And he may have done some stuff in his life that he wasn't proud of. He had a past in the text. And the honest folk outside today will testify, I got a past too. The people who come through the doors of the church, which will always be open to all, and all means all, will come with a story. All of us got a story. You got a story, and I've got a story. All of us has a past that's been shaped and shaped the perception of our present and our future. I know I've done some things I shouldn't have done. I've gone some places I shouldn't go. It's not always seedy and shady, but I've had moments when I didn't say the right thing. Moments when I didn't go where God was telling me. Moments where I didn't listen to my mama's advice. We all have a past. Some of you in your past, you've been hurt. Some of you have been abused. Some have been controlled by some substance, comforted by some bottle. Some of you been, somebody got some skeletons in your closet right now, and every now and then they start to rattle on you. Maybe you've been bitter because of some church clique or some conflict. Maybe you've been mean or manipulative. Maybe you were told that you weren't good enough or smart enough. You ain't been here long enough. You didn't know enough. Maybe you were set up by somebody you thought had your back till you died. Maybe you were let down by people who told you they would always be there for you. But the hope of this text is that your past experience, your previous decisions can't stop you from seeing Jesus. Your past doesn't limit you from getting closer to the Master. One of the great tricks of the devil is that he convinces you that you can't really see Jesus. You can't access the Savior until you get all of your stuff together. Until you got perfect thoughts, you have to live a perfect life with a perfect understanding of your perfect purpose. And so what we do is we keep delaying our dealings with Jesus until we try to get it right ourselves. One of the other tricks of the evil one is to try to convince you that Jesus is bound by how you've only experienced him in the past. If the movement of God does not come in the proper package or the package you like, if it doesn't suit your fancy, then you can't get with it. The devil is a liar that comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Yeah, you can't really start living life with joy. You can't live with endurance until you meet Jesus. You don't have to be perfect, but you got to be willing to yield to who God is. You got to be willing to yield to perfection personified, whose name is Jesus. You got to tell somebody, don't believe the hype about getting yourself together first. For the Bible says, if any man is in Christ, he's a new creature and old things are passed away. You're not limited by past experiences. You do know showing up on Sunday doesn't mean you're getting closer to Jesus. You got to show up with an open heart. You got to show up with an open soul. You might have gone through some terrible stuff in the past, or maybe you feel like you haven't done enough in your past. None of us has prayed our best prayer. None of us has given our best gift, rendered our best service, sacrificed our best sacrifice. I haven't preached my best sermon, but the Lord overlooks all of that and reveals himself to you. Just because you've never done something doesn't mean that God can't give you the strength to do something you never thought you'd be doing. Just because you haven't finished that degree doesn't mean you can't do it. Just because you've never written a book, never been a public speaker, never served on that ministry, never been active in the church, never worked in the community, none of that means that God can't give you the power, the strength, and the skill to do what you've never done. And if we're going to overcome this divided government, if we're going to overcome an afflicted community, a dysfunctional system, and a broken church community, we all going to have to be willing to do some things that we've never done. We're going to have to let God take our natural ability and add his supernatural ability to make our natural work in a supernatural way. Because the truth is that if he showed up for Zacchaeus in that tree, he'll show himself to you and to me. If you've ever seen The Lion King, The Lion King in the movie, The Lion King, you'll remember when Simba had run away to the land of Hakuna Matata and he forgot who he was. And you remember there was a little baboon named Rafiki. Rafiki had a stick in his hand, and Rafiki hit Simba over the head, and Simba said, Rafiki, why did you do that? And the baboon looked at him and said, it's in the past, what does it matter? And that's all I'm trying to tell somebody, is that your past experience does not have to paralyze your present or your future. Jesus stops by to tell you, that is in the past, so what does it matter? Do I have a witness in here who's got a Rafiki testimony, who know that your past can't cripple you, your past can't limit you, because God will forgive you, God will free you up, God will favor you, God will fight for you, God will defend you, God will direct you, disrupt you, deliver you. Somebody shout, no limits. Secondly, though, not only are you not limited by your past experiences, you're also not limited by public opinion. Amen. You're not limited by what the person beside you thinks about you. Help me, Holy Ghost. The folk who were in the seat of religious power wanted to work to keep Zacchaeus confined to the box they placed him in. It doesn't matter what the White House says. We are not limited by their opinion of us as people. They didn't want him to have access to religious freedom, access to spiritual awakening, access to a new sense of purpose and place in the world. Their opinion of him was that he was a no-good scoundrel who didn't deserve to be welcome at the table they were sitting in. Public opinion should be important. You should work to ensure that you're avoiding the appearance of evil, bias, and presupposition. But people can't stop you from growing closer to God and being who God called you to be. Don't you ever let a person or group of people, I don't care how big or small the group may be, don't you let them limit the service you give to the greater good. Nobody, and I mean nobody, should have that kind of power over your life. Zacchaeus was determined to get a glimpse of God's glory, and so he did whatever he had to do to get closer. He had to climb a tree, he had a little money, he had some authority as a tax collector, and here he is up in a treetop just trying to see Jesus. See, some of us won't even get up and come to church if it's raining outside. Some of us won't come to church if we got a pain in our toe. Some of us give up at the first sign of adversity. Some of us give up when some small roadblock comes up. We lose hope and lose interest if we don't get the support of people. But I've been sent to tell you that if you're willing to do whatever you have to do to get closer to God, then public opinion can't stop you from growing. The first grade teacher asked the class, what color is a pear? What color is a pear? Most of the children shouted, green. A pear is green. A few said, yellow. I've seen yellow pears, Miss Teacher. One child said, brown. I've seen a brown pear. One boy, though, raised his hand and said, I said, white. The color pears is white. The teacher explained perfectly that pears can be green or yellow or brown, but never white. The little boy was insistent, though, as little boys can be. And finally said, if you want to see the white, you got to look inside. And God just wanted you to know that to overcome negative public opinion in order to grow closer to God every day, in order to live with no limits, then you got to have something on the inside. You got to have faith inside. Faith is substance. And that word substance literally means setting under you. So if you're going to grow with no limits, if you're going to live with no limits on the potential and possibility for your life, then you must have faith underneath you as your support. All that chair right now is holding you up and keeping you from hitting the floor. That's what faith is. It's the foundation for your growth. Your faith ought to be under you to keep you from falling. Let me try it this way. Let's say you made up in your mind that right now you were going to go to Mitchell's Ice Cream. You were going to go to Mitchell's Ice Cream, and you're going to get some ice cream from Mitchell's, and you decided that you're going to have a sundae. You were going to get a sundae, and what they do is you choose the ice cream. I choose cookie dough ice cream or cookies and cream ice cream. They take the whipped cream. They take some hot caramel and I add peanuts and they put a cherry on top. Now, as I talked about that for somebody, you already have hope because your taste buds were activated. You started salivating when I was talking. Even though you ain't at Mitchell's just yet, your taste buds have, some of y'all gonna go to Mitchell's right after church. Your taste buds have hope. That's what faith is. Faith causes you to anticipate your future with God. It overcomes public opinion. It overcomes your anxiety. It overcomes your worry. It overcomes your dread. That's why the songwriter said, what have I to dread? And what have I to fear? Because I'm leaning by faith on the everlasting arms of God. You want to taste something about your future. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. And Zacchaeus hadn't seen Jesus, but what he heard about him made him expecting about meeting him. So he decided, I don't care what you say about me. I don't care what you think about me. I've come to see Jesus. I don't care what you say. I don't care what you do. I'm here to see Jesus. You're not limited by what they say. Your hopes don't hinge on what they say. Your power isn't wrapped in what they say. Your favor isn't connected to what they say. See, you know, they say has gotten folks spiritually messed up. If you want to get close, then get closer to God. And the closer you are, the more you realize that it's God's opinion that shapes your future. It's God's opinion that determines your growth. It's God's opinion that dictates deliverance. It's God's opinion, and God's opinion is he'll lead you beside still waters. He'll lead you in the path of righteousness. He'll keep you in perfect peace. He'll be your light and your salvation. Your growth is not limited by public opinion.
Amen.
You're not limited by past experience. Your growth is not limited by public opinion. But since you're not limited by past experiences, since your growth is not limited by public opinion, I'm done after this. You are liberated by God's powerful presence. You're free. You're free. Say, I'm free. I'm free. Jesus does something that the religious leaders of the day would never do. He goes to Zacchaeus' house. It's the powerful presence of Jesus in his midst at his house, which ultimately sets Zacchaeus free to live a life with God that has no limits on who he can become. Jesus goes to his house, and immediately Zacchaeus' house is transformed into a place where the Spirit of God dwells. And if you're willing to fight through the liabilities or limitations of your yesterday, if you're willing to tell the haters and the negative public prognosticators, you need to tell them to get a life, because I got to get a life myself, a life that's rooted in Jesus. Then you're a candidate for God's powerful presence. See, I believe that Jesus admired Zacchaeus' tenacity, his grit, and his determination. And if you've got that same kind of resolve, God will show up in your life. And when God shows up, you got to realize that he doesn't show up because you necessarily deserve him to show up, but he shows up for his name's sake. That's why you and I can't sit and judge folk who come to church, who come down the aisle and join God's church. You can't critique them and sit in your hollow seat as if you have perfected perfection yourself, because you don't get to determine who God's presence touches. And maybe if you and I had more of his presence, we'd be more loving and sincere. Maybe we'd have more joy. Maybe we'd love ourselves and our neighbor. You don't know who God will use. You don't know who God will touch and who he'll reveal himself to. All I know is that I want to be in his presence, because his presence makes us the beloved community where all are welcome and none are left out. His presence makes us move beyond petty bickering into the sunlight of God's glory. His presence reminds us that the sacrifice you make today ensures your future tomorrow. His presence makes you give yourself over to something larger than you. His presence will make us pray together, to sing together, to stand together, weep together, plan together, praise together, and shout together. And I don't know about you, but I want the presence of the Lord. The song writer said the presence of the Lord is here. I can feel him in the atmosphere. Is there anybody here that wants to be in the presence of God? You want the presence of God to walk with you, to talk with you, to remind you that you belong to him. On the way to church one Sunday, home from church one Sunday, little girl turned to her mom and said, Mom, the preacher's sermon confused me today. Mom said, Why did he confuse you? Look, little girl replied, well, the pastor said God is bigger than us. Is that true? Mama said, yeah, that's true, sweetheart. God is bigger than us. And he also said that God lives inside of us. Is that true, mama? Does God live inside? He's bigger than us and he lives inside of us. I'm little, mama. Again, mama replied, yes. Well said, little girl, if God is bigger than us and he lives inside of us, then wouldn't he show through more? And that's one of the problems in our churches, in the fact that coming Christianity as a lifestyle, God doesn't show through. And God is looking for some people who want to live with no limits, and you're going to let him show through your life. Do I have any friends in here who want God to show through? When his presence shows up, it'll show through your life. No matter where you are or what you're doing, he'll show through. When nobody will join you, God will show through. When opposition arises, God will show through. When trouble comes, when sickness attacks, God will show through. Do I have any help out here that wants God to show through your life? When storm clouds rise, God will show through. When the burden is lifted, God will show through. When life is good to you, God will show through. When your dreams come true, God will show through. When God shows through, if you're criticized, ostracized, and isolated, segregated, scorned, and scandalized, when you're struggling or staggering, when you're messed up or mixed up, if you're wealthy or well, if you're powerful or pleased, if you're hopeful or helpful, God will show through. He'll show through in your walk. He'll show through in your talk. He'll show through in your house. He'll show through in your work. He'll show through in your service. He'll show through in your love. He'll show through in your kindness. No matter what's going on in your life, you live with no limits. When God shows through.
I'm through worrying, y'all. I know some of y'all are hot, you're sitting in the sun. Most of you don't know, most of us don't know who Kenny William Gordy is. Most of us don't know Kenny William Gordy. Kenny William Gordy is Motown legendary producer Barry Gordy's son. You might know him as Rockwell. Kenny had a problem though. Kenny had a real problem. His daddy is Barry Gordy, music mogul. Barry Gordy, multi-millionaire, recording. He writing some of the most historic music in our country. But Kenny couldn't sing. Kenny couldn't dance, and Kenny couldn't act. He was around music. His daddy was a music mogul, but none of that rubbed off on Kenny. Help me, Holy Ghost. He did, however, write a song under his alias, Rockwell. You may know the song. Some of you remember the jam, "I Always Feel Like Somebody Watching Me. Can't Get No Privacy." You ain't been in church all day long, or every moment of your life. I always feel like somebody's watching me. Can't get no privacy. He had a song. Y'all remember the jam? Well, after weeks of recording the song with his daddy producing the song, his daddy realized that his son couldn't sing. Son couldn't dance, and his son couldn't act. So he called on somebody else to help take the track over the top. Help me, Jesus, I'm almost done. He called on a brother. Some of y'all know who he is. He called on a brother by the name of Michael Jackson. Yeah, to drop in and sing the hook for Rockwell. So whenever you hear the hook, "I always feel like somebody's watching me." That ain't Rockwell, that's Michael Jackson singing on that hook. And his father had to send in somebody else with a little more command to take the song over the top and make the song. Y'all know where I'm going. Don't let me work so hard. He had to send in somebody else some reinforcements. And as I send you out of here today, good afternoon, Antioch. May the Lord bless you real good today. But I gotta remind you that there's a reason you can live with no limits. It's because your father has sent in some reinforcements. Over 2,000 years ago, he sent in reinforcements. On a hill far away, he sent in reinforcements. On Friday, it looked like he was limited. On Saturday, it looked like the mission had failed. But my Bible says that early on Sunday morning, Jesus got up to remind you that there are no limits and no boundaries. No limit to what God do with the Savior. His love has no limits. So I don't know about you, but I've decided that it's on Christ, the solid rock I stand. Do I have any on Christ believers out here today? On Christ, there's new possibility. On Christ, you get some new hope. On Christ, your dreams will come true. On Christ, there's new life for you. I can face tomorrow, because when he shall come, when trumpets sound, oh, may I then in him be found. Trust in his righteousness alone, for less to stand before his throne. On Christ, there's no limit on Christ. No limits in Jesus. No limits with God. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, neither has it entered into the hearts of men what God has in store for those who love him. And this we know, that all things, and I mean all things, work together for the good. limits to what we can do to turn this world upside down with love if we stand in Christ, on Christ, the solid rock. I stand. You're not limited by your past experience. You're not limited by public opinion. But you are liberated by God's powerful presence in your life. And don't ever forget, he's sending reinforcements. So you don't have to dance in life's dance. You don't have to sing life's song by yourself. Because you got a singing partner who can come in and take over where you can't fill it in. His strength is made perfect in my weakness. If you would stand with me as we pray together. Eternal God, we thank you today for your grace that is sufficient for us. We thank you, God, that we're not limited by our environment. No matter what people say about us or to us, we're not limited by our zip code, our area code. We're not limited by our yesterday, God, but we are liberated because you are with us. Yeah.